Cecil King, one-time chairman of IPC, publishers of the Daily and Sunday Mirror, and an organization which he made into the largest publishing corporation in the world, has for over 50 years been close to the seat of power in this country and confidant of world leaders elsewhere. Now, although we have met, I do not know him personally, but first became fascinated by his style some 15 or more years ago when I watched him on television as chairman of the Daily Mirror, expressing mild, ironic surprise that the interviewer should have assumed that he, Cecil King, actually read that kind of newspaper. Now, the publication of his diary some years later, 1965 to 70, and then 70-74, caused so many shrieks of anguish and anger that it was amazing he had any friends left. Some of his comments were so caustic, perhaps cruel, I came to the conclusion that possibly it was because he wasn't able to, or couldn't be bothered to, tell a lie. True or false, Mr. King?
Everything in the diaries is true. When I say this is what Mr. X said, that is what he said on that occasion. But you have to think that in spite of all the screams of anguish, think of what I might have said and quoted and didn't.
But someone else said you have an inconvenient devotion to truth.
I have. Yes, that's true. I regard lying as a sin, and though sin is a word that's dropped out of the English language of recent years, I feel that very strongly.
Your very devotion to truth possibly sometimes leaves you open to that charge of arrogance, of aloofness.
Oh, yes, all that. Oh, yes. I remember a man coming up to me, one of the advertising agents in London, and saying, "Look, Cecil King eats!"
Now, one of the times when I know that in your own heart you were chasing the truth was at what must have been the most crucial moment in your life. You'd built that enormous empire I've talked about, and you've taken on Harold Wilson, the Prime Minister, and challenged him in the Mirror. Now, within a week, your own board had not only deserted you, but had sacked you. What sort of impact had that got on you then and on your life since?
Well, I'd often told my directors that I had no shares, I was under no contract, and that any afternoon they could call a board meeting and vote me out of office. No secret about it. But to send the assistant secretary of the company in a car at 8:15 in the morning to hand me a letter signed by 13 directors saying I was out seemed to me a particularly contemptible action.
When someone asked Hugh Cudlip if they felt they had stabbed you in the back, he said, "No, we nobly stabbed him in the front."
Well, that's if that's his standard, I've no comment to make.
Did you feel that your world was in ruins at that moment?
No, I was 67. I was going to retire quite soon anyway. I felt that people for whom I'd done a very great deal, to treat me like that was contemptible, and of course have had no further contact with any of them.
But of course, at that point, you wielded immense power. One way or another, immense influence. You were privy to a tremendous amount of information. How did you achieve this? How did you get there?
Well, do you mean to go back to the new Mirror when it was started?
No, just you as a person, because in some of your writings I detect a sort of feeling of insecurity, whereas and looking at it straightforward, you come from a very privileged position and should have been protected all your life, but you didn't feel protected, did you?
Well, the Harmsworth family did their best to get me dismissed from the Mirror. And I had, after all, no money. I had no shares. My career in Fleet Street was built largely on bluff. How could you feel secure? If you were Beaverbrook, you had a controlling interest in the paper, nobody could touch you.
But when you say largely on bluff, bluffing that you knew something you didn't know?
No, that I went on as if I controlled the business, when in fact I didn't. I couldn't. I hadn't got the money. And I didn't want to. I could have made a lot of money, but I'm not interested in making money.
By doing something else, do you mean? How would you have made the money if you by leaving newspapers, do you mean?
Well, I mean, you once, Rodemere or Northcliffe or the Berries, they all made huge sums of money out of newspapers. And I was at least as intelligent as they were. But I wasn't interested in that.
Did you, in fact, not end up making an awful lot of money by normal standards?
Well, no, not really. I don't know. I mean, I had a good salary, but nothing out of the way at that time. No.
Did you feel any sense of destiny?
No. I found myself in the Daily Mirror, which was obviously heading for the cemetery. And if I was to keep my job, I had to resuscitate it.
But I don't think the family were all that pleased at his resuscitation, were they?
Oh, no. After all, they'd all got peerages and fortunes, and they didn't want to be reminded that it was all based on a popular press. A lot of snobs, anyway.
Were you a snob yourself?
I would think not. Even Hugh Cunliffe, who doesn't seem to have been my warmest friend, said, well, at any rate, he was no snob.
But you were very determined, and I think you felt a great sense of success and power and went out of your way to get the sort of information you felt the Mirror wasn't getting, particularly at the time of the abdication crisis.
Yes, well, that was it. At the time of the abdication, the Daily Mail were involved, the Telegraph were involved, the Times were involved, and we knew nothing except what appeared in the other papers. And I determined then that this mustn't happen again. We must have contact all over so that we would know really what was going on.
And by the time we arrived at the 60s and you were still in this seat of power, yours were the only papers seriously supporting the Labour Party, and you'd great hopes, hadn't you, of Harold Wilson?
Harold Wilson had been the youngest cabinet minister for many years under Attlee. He was the youngest prime minister for a very long time. He had been a brilliant leader of the opposition. The Tories had been 13 years in office, and it was about time there was a change, and I had great hopes of Harold Wilson. But in the outcome, it appeared that what had got him where he was largely parliamentary skill, no political skill, no administrative skill. And of course, he was just a dismal failure.
You said of Wilson, a brilliant leader of the opposition, but disastrous prime minister.
Yeah.
And then you said of Heath, no politician and certainly no leader of the opposition. And you said of Alec Douglas Hume, he would make a good vice chairman of the Berkshire County Council. And indeed, another quote there of another member of the Labour Party, Lord Longford, just said, quite useless, mental age of 12.
I didn't say that. I quoted Wilson saying that.
Did you?
Yeah.
So you didn't believe
I quoted it. And when I handed him my manuscript to Frank Longford, on the front page was this quote. I must say he took it awfully well.
Well, for Mark Zim, I don't know that I'd take it awfully well, but generally speaking, we're leaving Frank aside. The average run of politicians, you obviously have not a great deal of respect for them.
Oh, well, who has? Not the British people, have they? They keep on changing them because they find them inadequate.
And you have the sense that not only are they inadequate, but that the system is failing, that democracy as we know it is failing, have you?
Oh, well, I think so. After all, if you think that when I was a child, England was the first country in the world. In 1950, it was at least the third country in the world. And now it ranks with Holland and Portugal as petty little European countries who once were centres of great empires. Well, that's not a brilliant record, is it?
No, and the time we were talking about earlier, when you were becoming disillusioned or had become disillusioned with Harold Wilson's government, you feared the government itself might collapse in a serious way.
Oh, I don't think so. I thought that... someday the government would have to tackle the trade unions, and when they did, there might be real trouble.
But outside of the system, did you not feel that you wrote, if I read you correctly, that men of leadership quality should come forward to form some sort of emergency government or temporary national arrangement?
Well, that's a hope. I mean, look what's happened now. Why is Mrs. Thatcher leader of the Tory party? A lot of the MPs don't like her policy, but there's only one leader in the whole lot. I mean...
leader, do you reckon?
Ted Heath was saying this the other day. He said, the only available leader. That's all there is. If you don't like that, well, then there's nothing.
Just to get back to what I'm saying, that I wasn't really talking about either party. I was trying to recall the much publicized occasion. And a theme running through your diaries all the time, you keep saying, my goodness, we must get somebody in, somebody should be helping out. The government is not able to do it. Something disastrous is going to happen. And then we hear or read of a meeting with you and the Earl of Mountbatten. I've read Hugh Cudliffe's version of it, and no doubt there have been other versions. That this was, as some people would say, was to stop or help to stop the country ending up in chaos as a result of mismanagement in government. What are the facts of that?
Well, this is what happened, if you're interested. Hugh Cudliffe said we'd been invited to see Lord Mountbatten at his private flat. So off we went. I had no idea what it was to be about.
It was his invitation, not you seeking a meeting with Mountbatten.
I had no idea what it was to be about. And when I got there, soon after we arrived, Zuckerman arrived, and Mountbatten said to me, I think I may have been alone then, and that Hugh and Zuckerman were elsewhere in the building. And Mountbatten said to me, the Queen had had more letters of criticism of the current government than any monarch had ever had. And she was considerably disturbed by this. And he felt that perhaps he ought to do something. What did I think? And I said I thought that at some point he might have a part to play as a distinguished naval officer and also his public position generally, but that at the moment I felt it was very important he should do nothing and keep completely clear. So he said, he agreed, and he was relieved to find that I thought the same thing, that the Queen was coming to stay with him, I think, at Broadlands the following weekend, and he would talk to her then about the whole matter. And I left and thought no more of the episode at all. I thought it was of no importance at all. And in fact stayed like that until 6 years later or something like that. Cudliffe published a book called, I think, Walking on the Water, in which he said that I asked to see Mountbatten in order to discuss a possible leadership of some kind of
an emergency government.
Hmm. So I immediately denied this story as widely as I could.
In fact, Hugh Cudliffe went so far as to say that Lord Zuckerman said to Mountbatten, have nothing to do with this, and turned dramatically at the door and said, it's treachery.
Well, I if he did, I didn't hear him say it. And if I'd heard him, I mean, after all, I made a diary note the same day, no mention of treachery.
Mountbatten didn't appear in your diaries, though. That wasn't in your published diary.
No, but there was an unpublished reference. When Cudliffe made this statement, I was concerned to say that I did not ask for the interview. Mountbatten asked me to call on him, and therefore that cut the bottom out of Cudliffe's story. I didn't want to mention that Mountbatten had asked about the Queen and all that, because I thought it was improper to drag the Queen's name into a criticism of a silly book by Cudliffe. So nothing happened for about 6 years until this book came out. Since when, at some monthly intervals, I have this same old story slung back at me. Since then, Cudliffe has admitted that, in fact, he and Pickering arranged a meeting, but they didn't tell me that. I didn't know what on earth we were seeing Mountbatten about.
So Mountbatten might have been of the impression through Hugh Cudliffe that it was you who called for the meeting.
I don't know. As far as I was concerned, I was asked to see Mountbatten. No statement of what it was to be about. None.
But does Hugh Cudliffe stand over the assertion that it was a government to take over, an emergency, etc., etc.? Or has he gone back on that?
Well, this is a telegram, I suppose, about that. sent me in March, I think it is, 81.
This is to you, yes, it's been. All this talk about an alleged military coup in 1968 has not come from me at any time and is grossly unfair on you. Stop. I have emphatically denied on radio, television, and in press interviews today that neither you nor I ever heard of such rubbish. Hugh Cudlip. Does the plot thicken or thin?
It may well be that certain politicians told my directors that I was planning a coup and that they knew that from the Secret Service with a view to getting rid of me, because they thought that without my presence the Mirror would support the Labour Party and they would romp home in 1970. But in fact, I thought that the Labour Party were going to lose in 1970 anyway, and why I was going cool on the Labour Party was I thought they were going to lose, and I didn't want the loss of an election to damage the Mirror. And of course, in 1970 came along, the Labour Party did lose, and so on.
Do you imply by that your directors, the original thing I was talking about, got rid of you because of this manufactured plot and not because your Enough is Enough front page to Wilson?
Oh no, because the Enough is Enough, that had been passed by Cudlip and all the editors before I published it, because after all, I didn't own the business.
But did you see yourself in any role, in any emergency government, in anything to save the country?
No, I saw myself playing the part that John Thaddeus Delane, that famous Irishman, played in the last century as editor of the Times. I think that a newspaper director, proprietor, whatever, can play a very useful part.
But you were looking for leaders, weren't you? Looking for good politicians.
Yes, right? If I could find one, I could have given them enormous publicity. But first find your man.
What is the quality you look for in your man? I mean, I notice in your diaries you have respect for Enoch Powell, you have respect on the continent for Strauss and the late Oswald Mosley. What qualities have they got that appeal to you?
Well, now, can I go back for one moment? The idea that the Secret Service might have been rolled into play to say that I was plotting a coup is ridiculous, because one of my closest friends, though possibly the conspirators didn't know that, was Burke Trend, Lord Trend, who I was very close to, and I told him always what I was doing, why and how and so on.
And he was a key figure in the Secret Service.
He was Secretary of the Cabinet at the time, and therefore the civil servant in charge of all the security services. And if he thought I was going too far in any direction, he would have been onto me like a flash and say, now, we're not going to have any of that. We were very close, and I kept him very well informed, so that in that rather dangerous field, if I put a foot wrong, I would be told so in no uncertain terms by the man in the very center of power.
You seem to have had a way with civil servants. You don't name them in your diaries, but top civil servants seem to tumble over themselves to give you information.
Well, there were particularly two. Burke Trend, for whom I had a great respect and admiration, and William Armstrong. I think William Armstrong, there's so many Armstrongs about, who had been head of the Treasury, and when I knew him best, was head of the Civil Service, afterwards chairman of the Middle Bank.
And you think they were entitled to give you information to which they were privy, you as a private citizen?
Oh, no, they didn't. I learned how to handle them. You see, if you ask them what they think of Minister so-and-so, not only will they not tell you, but the next time you ask them to lunch, they won't come. But if you say, I think Mr. X, the minister for whatnot, is a dud, look what he's done about this, look what he's done about that, I think he's a washout. If the civil servant said nothing, that meant he agreed. If he said, oh no, you're quite wrong, no, don't be unfair. Look what he's done about this, that, or the other.
You must be a very good bridge player, Mr. King. What are the qualities, just coming back to that, what sort of thing do you look for in leadership that seems to be missing from the people you know in society today?
Well, of course, I used to know many more than I do now. I thought Kennedy, President Kennedy, he had sought the presidency because it was the biggest prize in America. I thought that when I saw him about 3 weeks before he was assassinated, I thought that he was coming round to understand his appalling responsibilities and might well have achieved greatness if he'd given a bit of time. I mean, the important thing about a leader is that he has authority. So when if he says to somebody, go, he goes. He doesn't say why. I mean, this is the essential quality.
Yeah, but you can have authority and be a dictator that is...
Well, that's all right. There have been some excellent dictators.
Would you welcome a dictatorship if you could find a great leader in Britain today? Greater leader, with all due respect.
I'm retired. I'm 82 and I live in a little bungalow on the outskirts of Dublin. And
you're very happy doing that. And I noticed one other quote in your book, which is interesting. The happiest people I've known, you said, their standard of living was minimal. Do you mean that?
Yes. One of the happiest part of my career was building up the big newspaper empire in West Africa. And I liked the Nigerians enormously. Some of them had a little thatched hut. They had a bit of cloth to wrap around themselves and their family. They ate a dreary diet. They had enough food, but very, very, very dull. And that's all. And they were as happy as days long, laughing and having a great time. Wonderful people.
Would you apply that to our society here, that people with that in inverse proportion to your wealth is your happiness?
Well, we used to know Paul Getty, who was said at that time to be the richest man in the world. A more miserable man I never met. You know, you felt going up to him, putting an arm around him, saying, "Now look, old man, it really isn't as bad as that. I assure you, it isn't." And I had uncles who had huge fortunes and were miserable people. So I grew up with equating great wealth with unhappiness, because that's what I saw around my own family.
Let me ask you a question about the press. Looking back on the press now, there was a man you right in the thick of it. What do you think in general terms of the press of today and the recent hoo-ha with the press council and checkbook journalism and all the attacks that are being made on the press by the press?
I think that when I was in charge of the Mirror, I gave instructions to my reporters that they were not to be intrusive. And if they lost a story because of that, that would not be held against them. I couldn't do anything else, can I?
It would be naive to say, wouldn't it, that Daily Mirror reporters did not intrude on people during your regime?
They didn't. They knew they'd lose their job.
What do you call intrusion?
Well, the trouble about intrusion, which you can't get out of, is that if one discreet reporter calls on some bereaved widow, that may be all right. But if 80 reporters, all discreet, call on the same poor widow, I mean, that's absolute misery. But how are you to deal with that? No one person sends the 80, people send one. They don't know how many are going to be there when our one arrives. It's that is the difficulty, I would think.
When you talk about the 80, one thinks instantly, of course, of the royal family now, who've come under a lot of fire from the press. It's always 80 or more there. So do you think that they should have a stiff upper lip and bear this misery, to use your own word? Or are they entitled to complain?
Well, they want publicity, badly. They live on publicity. And it's impossible to divide into two sorts of publicity. It used to be said that there's publicity and no publicity. You can't divide publicity into good and bad.
So you don't think, for instance, that a young Princess Diana is entitled to say, please, I don't want to give any interviews. I want to be left alone till my baby is 3 years old.
I think if you go, you're Princess Diana, and you're photographed so well, and you're so attractive, and you go on a skiing holiday and expect to be left alone, well, I mean, somebody should have told her that that's not what she's going in for.
Let me ask you a last question, Cecil King. You've many more happy years ahead of you, I'm quite certain, but how would you like to imagine Fleet Street writing your epitaph? What would you like to be remembered for?
Well, I won't be remembered, but I would like them to remember that newspaper proprietors haven't got all to be crooks like Beaverbrook. They can be honest men, as I was.
Cecil King, thank you.